All right, now that we have a solid understanding of how to make NLP transfer learning possible, it's probably time to take a look at the state of the art in the field and what has changed since earlier approaches such as ELMO and ONFIT have been proposed. And that's pretty much the scope of our next chapter here. And let us start with a little timeline. Which starts in 2018. That was really the birth of NLP transfer learning with the ONFIT and the ELMO papers coming out early 2018. Fairly recently, if you think about it. But so much has happened since then. And first of all, I'm throwing in some acronyms here, all of which refer to NLP models that gained some popularity. More than some, actually. GPT or BERT or GPT-2, these models are really famous today. They are like celebrities in the field and have achieved very remarkable performance. One thing that we can note here is that the progress in deep learning-based NLP is really astonishing. Shortly after ELMO, it was June when OpenAI, the research lab that was once funded by Elon Musk, came out with their GPT model. And not that much later, Google released their BERT. BERT is still one of these models that are very much around and used these days. And later on, GPT-2 came out, which was an much modified and improved version of the original GPT model. Much progress later on, further approaches became available. Just before moving on, let's note the increase in the computational cost that was associated with the next generation NLP models. And as you probably know, when you build a deep learning model, the approach you would want to take is to not run the computations on the CPU of your computer, but to involve your graphical processing unit, your GPU, where, for example, NVIDIA is one of the great players in the market, offering state-of-the-art GPUs for deep learning and advanced analytics, or the acronym TPU stands for Transfer Processing Unit, if you wish. The TPU is a further specialized transistor or chip architecture that's focusing on numeric computations and matrix type of computations, the type of computations we need and apply in the scope of deep learning. So it's a chip architecture which Google developed specifically for the task of running large deep learning models on these chips. So if you wish, it's an even more powerful type of GPU. And I found some numbers in the Stanford course that I'm using a lot to inform my lecture, where they would equate one TPU day to roughly or something between 1.25 or 2.2 GPU days. Well, GPU is not a single type of chip. There are different versions, different generations, more powerful, less powerful, so it's impossible to really do the conversion exactly without knowing exactly what type of graphic card you have available, right? But this is to give us an idea, and just looking at GPT-2, the biggest model in this family here, 2048 TPU days. Now that is a lot. I mean, just don't get that right, given the vast progress in the field. Obviously, they did not let their model run for that many days. But if you had available only a single TPU, that is roughly the amount of days you would need to wait until the model has finished its training. So you really need a very powerful compute cluster where you have access to many TPUs in order to run these models in a reasonable amount of time. That's entirely different from when you want to use these models. That's costly enough in terms of computations, but it's not close to being as costly as training these models in the first place. Remember, it's still NLP transfer learning we talk about, right? And interestingly, when you look at this family here, the earlier two representatives, Elmo and Olmsted, as we have seen, they used stacked LSTMs as their underlying base model, if you wish. Whereas the later ones, GPT-2 and BERT, they are all based on a different type of neural network architecture, which is called the transformer architecture. So we will look at that architecture in detail, because it's really what many state-of-the-art models have under the hood. So you really should know about this architecture. And just to continue with the timeline, that's a different picture of the same phenomenon, where here we have time against the number of parameters in these models. How long it takes you to train a neural network depends on the compute power you have available. The powerful GPU, do you have a TPU, how many of these you've got? These are the drivers that determine your computation time. A more objective, if you wish, way to compare models and to appraise the growth in the computational demand associated with deep NLP models, you can look at the number of trainable parameters, how many weights you have got in these neural networks. And as you know, the more weights you have, the more free parameters you have, the longer you will need to train these models, and also the more data you would want to have available in order to train all these parameters. So definitely the number of free parameters is a determinant of the compute time that you need to train your models. And we see two interesting traits here in the graph, I believe. One, that even monster models like BERT or GPT-2, which came out late 2018 or early 2019, can be considered small compared to what has become available later. Again, this slide is vulnerable to get outdated, but clearly one of the biggest models that has ever been trained was the Megatron language model by NVIDIA. There is NVIDIA, I mean. They manufacturing these powerful graphic cards, these powerful GPUs that you use for deep learning. Makes sense that they are able to build this mega model, and maybe they just want their name also to be shown in these nice graphs here, right? So that's one trend, more and more parameters, which translates into more and more time and cost and energy to train these models. The second notable trend, I believe, is that you see represented by Roberto or Distelbert, these lower rightmost models, which have been released in mid-2019, so very late, being comparably small. So there are a bunch of models where the very motivation to build these models is to put an end to this growth of parameters, this growth of training times and cost. So there is a development in the field that basically turns away from building bigger and bigger models. And the names that you see here on the lower right part are just representative of this philosophy. Let's not make our models so big. Let's be a bit more considerate with the resources we have available. Do we really need these enormously big monster models, etc., etc.? That's the thinking that we also see in the field. So two power forces here that you can point out. In the reminder of the chapter, I will focus a little bit more on BERT and its underpinnings. So BERT is a model for text classification type of tasks. And whenever we as a group at my chair, in seminars, in lectures, use NLP, text classification is a very handy task. Sentiment analysis is just one example, or trying to use some text to inform prediction model that forecasts stock developments or financial time series in general. These are the type of use cases that are popular in business and economics. I believe text classification is therefore also a task that's interesting for you. And hence, if we look at the state of the art in text classification, there is a BERT. It's the elephant in the room. You cannot avoid it. You need to know about BERT. And the last of these timeline slides, I found this very nice. It was done by peer students from the 2019-2020 cohort. And it just further emphasizes the point that there is so much progress, so many models coming out, and only for this one type of model, sort of every month you have a new child in the BERT family. Here is also with Albert and the Roberta, these models I was mentioning earlier on, trying to be a bit more considerate when it comes to computational costs. We also have Camembert, which is BERT trained on a French corpus. Scholars obviously also trying to be a bit funny here, showing some humor in coining names for their models. And all these models, all these BERT family members, but also the GPT type of models, all these state-of-the-art models, most of them anyway, they use this architecture called the transformer, which has really taken over and have, well, outperformed, if you wish, the previous standard approach, which was a deep recurrent neural network using GRU or LSTM layers. That was the state of the art in NLP for a long time. And then there came the transformer, which is one paper, also by a group from Google Brain, published in 2017. Attention is all you need. This transformer model makes use of a mechanism that has been around before. That's called the attention mechanism. I think I was making some comments earlier about attention. We'll look at it. This mechanism has been around. But this group was the first to say, well, you know what? We can build a powerful NLP model using only this attention mechanism, or pretty much only that attention mechanism. We don't need anything else. Specifically, we do not need these recurrent calculations that we carry along if we use LSTM or GRUs as our base model. Convolutional neural networks were also very famous in the scope of NLP and still are. The transformer also sort of not put an end, but overcame CNN-based language models as well. So it's really the type of architecture that rules right now. No matter whether you talk about machine translation, language generation, question answering, classification, whatever you want to do with text, if you go for the state of the art, you're very likely to use a transformer model. So let's look at transformers. First of all, we can understand transformers as a principal type of architecture or an architectural pattern for sequence type of task. And although sequential data is more general and encompasses more than textual data, the field where transformers excel is text, is NLP. Should you be interested in applying transformer type of models to other sequence problems, like financial time series, a few papers exist, but not that many. So that's probably a very nice task for a master dissertation or something alike. And the important selling point of the transformer is that you can scale these models easier compared to recurrent neural networks, which require the sequential calculations. Sequential calculations are difficult to parallelize because one step needs the previous step, and so the previous step has to be completed before you can continue with the next step. And this recurrency makes the task of running the model, building the model, training the model in parallel in a big compute cluster very difficult. This is why RNN-based models don't scale so well. I'm jumping ahead. CNN type of models, convolutional neural networks, scale better than RNNs, so they also address this sort of computational bottleneck, or this parallelization bottleneck that we see in RNNs. Convolutional neural networks, on the other hand, when you apply them to text and you want them to pick up long-term dependencies, remember this is one of the common threats in NLP. When you develop a model, the question often is, can I capture long-term dependencies in language or can I not? RNN can, but they are hard to parallelize and thus don't scale that well. CNNs also are able to capture long-term dependencies, provided you make these networks really deep. And if you make these networks really deep, then again, the computational cost is sizable. So in terms of scaling things up, the transformer architecture promises to be more efficient compared to both RNNs, but implicitly also to CNNs. Which is why people have grown these models to become these very big monster type of NLP models, as shown earlier. The posts that I'm citing here, that by Rami Karim, and especially that of Jay Alamar, are very useful. I'm basing my material partly on these blogs, but you'll see the citations as we go along. And as always, I really invite you to also take a look at these blogs to follow up on the lecture. Very notable also is a blog/paper by the Harvard NLP group, where they took this famous Google paper, Attention is All You Need, which for a NIPS paper is very readable, but it's still a NIPS paper, so it's challenging at times. And they basically dissect this paper and support key parts with code. So they really build the type of model that is proposed in the paper, which is very cool idea. And if you go to the paper and want to read the paper, then maybe you want to start with the annotated version by the Harvard NLP group. That's a great achievement, I believe. What I will do, I will first of all introduce you to the attention mechanism, which is the heart of the transformer, but in the scope of the RNN-based language models that we have become accustomed by now, so that we introduce novel material one by one. So let's first of all have a look at the attention mechanism in more traditional RNN-based NLP models, where we will look at the sequence-to-sequence architecture. That's another architectural pattern that you often see in NLP. You have a sequence as input, and you have a sequence as output. And because of that, you call your model a sequence-to-sequence model, because you map an input sequence to an output sequence. Language generation is a perfect example. When you generate language, well, you have an output sequence. And typically, this output that you would generate depends on some input sequence. So for example, you initiate or initialize a language generation model with part of a sentence and then ask it to finish that sentence. Likewise, machine translation is in our NLP task where we would use a sequence-to-sequence architecture. Thinking about it, machine translation is probably an even better example. You have a text in the source language. In my example, that's German. Mir gefiel die Vorlesung. If you don't know German, that says I liked the lecture. We have our source language. Let it be German. And we would like to translate that into a target language. Say that is English, so we have an input sequence and an output sequence. This type of sequence-to-sequence architecture, for example, is also used in Google Translate and other type of translation services. So that's how you do machine translation. And you can do that with RNNs, and it's done with RNNs, or at least it was done with RNNs before the transformer took over. But let's have a look what the issue is in the traditional sequence-to-sequence architecture. And you see some papers here where you can read up. These are the papers introducing that architecture for machine translation. You find the full citations later on in the slide book. We have an RNN, which we call the encoder. It's just an RNN. It's nothing fancy. It's just a neural network, specifically an RNN. We feed it some text, a sentence such as Mir gefiel die Vorlesung, I liked the lecture. And with every input token, with every word that we put into the RNN, the hidden state gets calculated and the hidden state accumulates. And at the end, once we've inputted the last word in our sequence, which is Vorlesung, that is in English, that is lecture, then we have the full hidden state, so to say, accumulated over all the previous tokens in the sequence. And that hidden state, the last hidden state in the encoder RNN, we use to initialize our decoder RNN. That is important. That's the core. That's the pivotal point of the sequence-to-sequence architecture. How we ensure that these two networks, the encoder and the decoder RNN, work together. And first you put your text through the encoder, the hidden state accumulates, and in the end, once you're done, once you've said the last word in your input text to the encoder RNN, the hidden state of the encoder RNN encapsulates all the information that has accumulated during the processing of your input sequence. And it's highlighted in yellow here. You use this aggregated piece of information, the network's view on the source text, and initialize the decoder RNN. That means that the hidden state in the decoder RNN, when you start the decoding bit, then you feed the decoder also an input token, which in my example is a token start. We will also see later that in several NLP tasks it's common practice to introduce tokens that have a specific meaning into the vocabulary. Like this token here, start, it's meant to tell the decoder that now it's your task to start with the decoding. So generate me the first word in the target language. That's one input to the decoder RNN, and the second input to the encoder, to the decoder RNN, is this last hidden state from the decoder RNN, this big fat yellow arrow that we see here. So these two pieces of information, they come together. Here they come together. And then you use the hidden state to produce a prediction. You basically add a SoftMerks layer where you have a unit per word in your vocabulary. And then you have a weight matrix that when multiplied with the hidden state vector of your decoder RNN, gives you a probability distribution over words. And to make things simple, you just go for the word that receives the maximal probability. In my example, that's the word I. And then you pick that word. So this is the first word that you generate in your translated sentence. This argmax thing, so predicting a probability distribution over words and then going for the word that has the highest probability, is a simplification. If you want to build a state-of-the-art machine translation model, you would put attention into improving upon this choice of the word that you output. You can do that better, that's what I'm saying. But conceptually, just using the word that receives maximum probability as output works out, is possible, that's what I'm saying. And then the I, so you have your first word in the target language, that becomes, as you see, the next input for the second computational step in the decoder RNN. There, you use the new input token, which is I, and the previous hidden state from the previous step in order to calculate the new hidden state, to do the updating. The updating will depend what type of RNN do I use. Is it vanilla RNN? Is it GRU? Is it LSTM? What is it? But you update your hidden state. That's what you do. Or if it's a stateful type of LSTM with a memory cell, you would update your cell memory as well. But that we did before. Nothing changed here. And this is how you continue with the decoding. And hopefully, in the end, you will get a sentence that represents the original input sequence translated to the target language. So the decoder RNN gives us a language model in that it predicts the next word in the sentence. That is exactly what a language model is doing. And this language model of the decoder RNN generates target sentence conditional on the encoding. And conditional on the encoding, if we are precise here, we say it's conditioned on the hidden state of the top layer of the RNN. If the encoder is stacked RNN with multiple layers, then we would focus on the top layer and the very last step in that top layer. So the hidden state of Vorlesung, in my example. This is what we condition on. And that is a bottleneck. That is an information bottleneck. And attention has been invented to overcome this information bottleneck. The final encoding, the encoder output, needs to capture all the relevant information about the source sentence. But that's a challenging task. And what is really relevant for the translation that may and often will vary with context. If we consider this sentence here, when you're trying to generate the word liked in the second step of the decoder, then different words in the input text might have different importance to get a high probability for the word like. The fact that the first input token in the source sentence, mir, or in English, I, that's a pronoun, so that is indicative that now we might need a word. So mir, I, could imagine that to be particularly important for the prediction of like as the next word, while other words in the input sequence, for example, the article, the lecture, D in German, the article D, this guy here, is that very indicative in order to predict liked at the second step? Probably not. But the fact that this word occurred in the input sequence will be reflected in the hidden state, although we might not need it. Attention tries to offer a better way to make use of the information that the encoder RNN has produced. Since if you just look at the picture, it appears a bit naive to only use the last hidden state. We also have that hidden state. Do we not? And we have that hidden state. And in fact, we have that hidden state as well. For every token in the input sequence, we calculate a hidden state. But we sort of throw overboard everything and only use the last one, which of course incorporates information from the previous step. When we decode. And attention allows us to do that better. Here's attention. We calculate an attention distribution on each step of the decoding. And in each step of the decoding, this attention distribution will signal to us which of the words in the input sequence are currently most important. And when I say which of the words in the input sequence are currently most important, now the input words in the input sequence, they are represented by their corresponding hidden state. So in the first step of the decoding, we basically feed the token, system token if you wish, the token start into the decoder. Because we don't have a first word, we just start the decoder, now go on, start, we feed the first token in. And now the question is, considering the input sequence, mir gefiel die Vorlesung, what's most important of these words in order to now output the English word of mir? And the way we determine that, or try to determine that, taking the embedding of our start token, every word is a vector, everything is embedded, right? So taking the vector of our start token, we compute the scalar product with every hidden state in the input, in the encoder RNN. The dot product calculated between two vectors tells us something about the similarity of these two vectors, right? We've seen that in the context of the cosine similarity, but it's also intuitively plausible, I believe, if you have two vectors of the same dimension and you just calculate the scalar product, if the two vectors at one position have the same sign, the output position after calculating the dot product will be positive. Right? So if there is similarity between the two vectors that we of which we calculate the scalar product, for one position the numbers have the same sign, we get a positive output. And whenever for a given position the sign is not the same, the output will be negative. So just looking at the sign, the dot product tells us a little bit about the similarity. And if we add to this consideration the magnitude that we see if we are in position one of our two input vectors and we both see two large positive numbers at position one, well, apparently, considering only that dimension, the two input vectors are similar. So calculating the dot product overall tells us something about the similarity between these two vectors. And in order to ensure that these similarities are not only numbers between plus and minus infinity, we put them through a softmax operation and get a nice probability distribution out of that. We get a probability distribution which of the input words are most related to the current decoder step. And, well, let's assume the most important word is the first one, mir, in the input sequence. I arbitrarily selected that. I just needed one, right? we can now use this attention distribution, which because of the softmax will just be a probability distribution, the sum of which adds up to one, in order to weight the hidden states in the encoder part. So we can now compute the weighted sum of the encoder hidden states, all the encoder hidden states, that's the key thing, not only the last one, but all of them, using the attention distribution. That's just a weighted average. And the attention output is largely based on the information from the hidden state that receives the highest attention at this decoding step. Let's augment the picture a little bit. That's what we can do. We basically augment the hidden state in the decoder RNN, not only initializing it with the last hidden state of the encoder RNN, instead we concat the vector in the decoder RNN and have an enriched hidden state RNN. Combine the attention output I put with the decoder hidden state, and afterwards we can compute our forecast, our outputs, just as before, just from a different decoder hidden state, which now includes the attention output. Of course, the attention output is just a vector, and we will make sure that the dimensionality of that vector matches that of the decoder hidden state, so that we can nicely put these vectors together. And when we move on with our decoding, let's say in step one we predicted the word I, the word I is now our new input for the decoder in the second step. For this input I, we take the embedding vector of I, we calculate the attention distribution by looking at the scalar product between the embedding of I and all the hidden states of the encoder RNN, and putting the resulting scores of these dot products through a softmax, we get a new attention distribution. And to make that somewhat plausible, I attributed the highest weight in my attention distribution to the word Gefiel, which is the German equivalent to liked. And we can once again calculate a weighted sum over all the hidden states, considering the attention weights. That gives us the attention output. That output we use alongside the decoder hidden state to have an enriched hidden state in the decoder, and we can derive forecast from that enriched hidden state. And this is how it goes on. So we have a new input which is liked, because we predicted liked in step two. We check, given the embedding of liked, which of the hidden states in the encoder RNN is most relevant when we're looking for the word that follows liked. We calculate the dot products, we calculate the probabilities, our attention output, and this is how we go along. Next word is the. Again, we have a new attention distribution, so we get the attention distribution for every decoding step, and we allow that in every decoding step the attention distribution differs, and it will differ by design. And this is how we overcome this information bottleneck that we routinely look only at the last hidden state in the encoder part, as previous machine translation approaches did. That is the advantage of attention, that we use the information from the encoder hidden states more carefully. We make more out of this information. That's the idea. Let's try to put some structure into that. So, attention summarized. Before I promise too much, interim summary, right? We're just at the, we've just scratched the surface of attention, sorry. Nonetheless, so that has been introduced in the scope of neural machine translation to overcome the information bottleneck in RNN-based language models that follow the sequence-to-sequence architecture pattern. Although it was introduced in that scope, it's actually something more general. Nowadays, it's a standard type of operations that you see in many deep models. Image models, for example, heavily use attention layers or make use of the attention mechanism. So do various NLP models. So it has become standard practice to incorporate these attention layers to allow focusing on individual tasks. Attention image processing, for example, would allow you to look into different parts of a picture. If you do image captioning, for example, you generate words that are to describe your image. And depending which word you generate right now, what's your current, the next word, different parts of the image might be most important. And attention is the vehicle with which you can identify these parts that are currently, for the current operation, most important. It's a general purpose type of mechanism. That sounds a little bit more formal. If we're trying to formalize it a little bit, then we are given a set of vector values and a vector query. And then attention is a technique to compute a weighted sum of the values dependent of the query. Let's try to put that into the context of the previous example with the machine translation model. What was the vector values and what was the vector query? Well, it's actually not that difficult. Noting that we calculate a weighted sum of the values conditioned on the query. The vector values, therefore, are, in the example, the different hidden states in the encoder RNN, which we have computed for every input word in the source text. These are the vector values. And the vector query was the embedding of our input token in the decoder part. So, for example, in the first decoding step, we fed the token start into the decoder, and the embedding of that token start, that would be the vector query in this definition. Intuition, the weighted sum, is meant to give you a selected summary of all the information contained in the values. Trying to translate that. Selective summary of all the information captured in the hidden states of our encoder RNN. And the query determines which of the values to select, which are most important at the current processing step. Current processing step. So you see it's very much geared toward sequence-to-sequence type of models, sequence models, general. Well, in addition, that's just a point you might want to know, you might not. Attention is also a way to obtain a fixed size representation of an arbitrary set of representations dependent on some other representation. That's a tough one, I guess. The colors help a little bit. A set of representation are input vectors. Some other representation is the vector query. And this last point is essentially trying to say that, well, even if the dimensionalities of the vectors don't work out naturally, let's say you use a different embedding dimension in the encoder for your source language than you use for the decoder for your target language in machine translation. Not saying you should, but let's imagine you do that. Then this initialization if you go the traditional way, here you might have some problems. The hidden state that you build up in the encoder RNN, you use that to initialize the hidden state in the decoder part. But let's revise my example a little bit. Let's say you use a different dimension for your RNN units in the decoder part. Well, attention could help you out here. Arranging the computations in a sensible way, you can get rid of issues with differences in the dimensionality of the vectors that you are trying to process. That's another advantage of attention. But it's not the main point. The main point really is this selective summary. So that became state of the art or standard practice to apply attention. And then this paper came out. Attention is all you need. And it created a lot of attention in the community for sure. Probably that's one of the most cited NLP papers right now. The paper first of all highlights the shortcoming of RNNs relating to the difficulties of building RNNs in a highly parallelized manner and the lack of really scaling up the parallelization of the RNN represents a computational bottleneck of that approach, especially if you want to train these things on bigger and bigger corpora. You need to parallelize your computations, otherwise you wait forever. A technique that's not easily parallelizable gives you a headache. That's the motivation for the transformer, an architecture that is based only on attention layers. Extended, adjusted, modified attention layers, but essentially only attention layers, where you avoid sequential computations entirely, and that alone raises your scalability. And there are multiple, well, terms and ways of calculating attention score, self-attention, multi-head attention, encoder-decoder attention. Very confusing at first. Actually, it's not such a big deal, and we will hopefully see that it's not such a big deal. The paper also makes the point that long-term dependencies, our running thread long-term dependencies, are better captured in a transformer-based network compared to an LSTM. So they really became the successors of RNNs in all their colors in the field of NLP. Once again, the annotated paper, in addition to reading the NIPS paper, the annotated version by Harvard NLP group, I like a lot. They use, however, PyTorch to do the computations. So before going there, you might want to have a quick look into PyTorch to familiarize yourself with the syntax that you see and how Python is used there. As you will remember, we use Keras in our practical. So it's probably a good idea to have a quick look into PyTorch before spending much time with the annotated paper from the Harvard group. This is a graph that you also see a lot on the internet, which comes from the paper to sketch the transformer architecture. And what we see here, it takes a while to orientate ourselves in that picture. But we do see, if we look closely and understand the picture, we do see an encoder-decoder type of architecture. The left part is the encoder part and the right part is the decoder part. So that's still a nice architecture that you can envision to be useful when you do machine translation. Source language, target language, encoding the source text, then generating the same text or expressing the same concepts in the target language. Encoder captures relatedness among the input tokens through an attention mechanism. You see this multi-head attention in orange here in the architecture. You see it a lot. It occurs both in the encoder and in the decoder. And you also may note something called a positional encoding. That's something we need to look at. Essentially, we have input embeddings and output embeddings, which we put into our encoder and decoder network. Vectors, these are just vectors. We represent words as vectors still, or tokens as vectors, and put these vectors into our encoder and decoder. That's as before. What happens with these input then is that they are put through a multi-head attention mechanism. And that happens both in the encoder part and in the decoder part. Probably helpful if I highlight what I'm talking about in the graph. So here we have a, for highlighting red is probably a better color and more useful. Here we have multi-head attention, and here we have multi-head attention. Okay, we have masked multi-head attention. That's a adjustment that we make and we need to make in the decoder part. Don't worry, it's just an attention operation that processes our inputs. As far as the decoder is concerned, we then, well, have at a norm, we have a layer normalization step. You have seen that before. Think about batch normalization, something like that. Then we put everything through a forward neural network or feed-forward neural network. Have another round of layer normalization. And actually, let me get rid of this annotation. Note that bit. NX. NX also here. So the whole part here, that is called one transformer block. It's an element, sort of, well, it's an element in the transformer architecture, which you can stack upon each other. You can stack these transformer blocks very much as you can stack multiple RNNs on top of each other to make the model deep. And contemporary NLP models make use of that and stack many transformer layers on top of one another. And you can do that both in the encoder part and in the decoder part. At some point you're done, and from the top transformer block in the encoder, we talked about the stacking, you basically take your output, the encoded representation of your source text, and put that into the decoder. That resembles the way how in RNN-based sequence-to-sequence models, the last hidden state in the encoder initializes the hidden state in the decoder. There is communication between the encoder and the decoder. That is the common situation in an encoder-decoder architecture. Same here. We take the outputs of these transformer-based encoder network and put that into the decoder network. We see that before, the tokens that we feed into the decoder have already gone through one of these attention mechanisms. Then, using a second attention mechanism, they are combined with the output of the encoder. Thereafter, we put the result through another feed-forward neural network, calculate a layer normalization. We repeat these blocks multiple times, potentially, and times. And in the end, we, that's this bit here, produce some output. In summary, we have these transformal blocks that are highlighted using the grayish background. They look slightly different in the encoder than they look in the decoder. but only slightly, well, they look more than slightly different maybe, but the calculations are actually not that different. And these transformer blocks we can stack on top of each other as long as we like. Each transformer block has an input, which is basically a token, a sequence of embedded tokens. These positional encodings, we deal with them later. And then at the very end, we have some architectural pattern that we put on top of the decoder transformer. For example, to generate a distribution over words, very often in NLP, this is what we want and need. To do that, we could stack a softmax layer on top of the transformer, a linear layer, and then softmax afterwards to get output probabilities. So a deep neural network, if we make this big N big enough, then it's a deep neural network consisting of multiple architectural blocks. These are called transformer blocks. And well, although there are multiple operations going on in these transformer blocks, we have this normalization, we have a feed-forward neural network, we have multiple operations, but you know feed-forward neural networks, and you know that they have been introduced in 1974 or so, so that is not new. Layer normalization also, that is not new. The key novelty here are clearly these transformer, these transformer blocks are the attention mechanisms. And this is what we will look at in detail. We will now take apart this transformer architecture, focusing mainly on the attention, but also touching on the other parts of the architecture. So let's have a look. Attention is all you need, they say. Okay. Then let's try to make some sense out of attention. I'm drawing on the pictures from Peter Blum, who has written this beautiful blog, Transformers from Scratch, where you also would find a lot of code in PyTorch. It's somewhat similar to the annotated paper by the Harvard group, a bit more readable or more geared toward a non-NLP audience or a general data science audience, or I don't know how to put that. A bit easier to read maybe. Okay, so transformers. We map input to output sequences, of course. That is what we do in sequence-to-sequence modeling. We have input vectors and output vectors. And let's denote inputs and outputs by X and Y respectively. That should sound familiar. And the output is calculated as a weighted average. Let's try to make sense of Peter's picture. The vectors are represented by rectangles, where then we see three-dimensional vectors, because each of these little pillars has three dimensions. So let's try to annotate that a little bit. I'm using black here. So that little guy here is x1, that is x2, we've got x3, and x4. The students fell asleep. Four tokens, for instance. But of course, we embed them, and so we have these input vectors, and we also have four output vectors. Y1 to Y4 in our sequence-to-sequence architecture. So now we have a bunch of computations here. These self-attention mechanism that we find in the transformer, it calculates an output based as a weighted average over inputs. Now that is exactly what we saw before when looking into attention in the scope of RNN-based models. There we also saw these dot products between vectors, and we also saw the attention distribution that we were calculating and the weighting averaging. That sounds quite similar, quite reasonable. So let's try to take that down. The output is a weighted average of the inputs, obviously, of what else. So if we have an output, yi, that is a weighted average of the input. Okay, well, a weighted average. So let's say we have weights w, I, j, and the input is j, xj, and the sum also runs over j. That is just a weighted average, where a single output token, yi, emerges based on a weighted sum over the inputs j, xj, each of which has a weight. So that is to say, we use x1, x2, x3, and x4. We could actually put that down, that's maybe helpful. J equal to 1 to 4 of our four inputs. And 4 here is the sequence length. So the 4 in my example is the small t. It's the sequence length. I use the symbol d for the embedding dimension. So if I use Word2Vec, for instance, I could embed every word, the students fall asleep, and could map these words to a vector of dimension 300. If I'm using the 300 dimensional Word2Vec, that I could do. Okay, so we calculate it as a weighted average from the inputs. Where do these weights come from? Well, the weights are the red rectangles in the picture. And then you see how the input x1, 2, 3, and 4, they are multiplied with these little red rectangles, which are the corresponding weights, and then added up to deliver you the output y2. That's clearly something we need to add to our picture. The picture shows us the derivation or the calculation of output y2. And so that is y21. That is to resemble y22, y23, and y24. These weights. And then the picture starts to make sense, I hope, because now we basically can identify this summation, this weighted sum in the picture. And the missing bits here, where the input vectors reoccur and are shown multiple times, that we yet need to make some sense of. What you see by looking carefully is that one input vector reoccurs, this one here. If you look at the color coding, that is x2. X2, that's hard to identify as x2, x2 reoccurs, which is because we are looking for the output y2. And x2 is the corresponding input. But in order to calculate that output, we need these weights. And these weights essentially follow from a scalar product of x2 with one of the other vectors. So here we've got x1, here we've got x2 a second time, here we got x3, and here we got x4. And now the picture makes a lot of sense, and we can try to put that into an equation. So wij, our weights, the key ingredient that we yet need to know about. We certainly know what x is. Apparently, that is what we calculate by means of a dot product between xi, XI. Me and my handwriting. I cannot apologize enough. Let's add a little transpose here to stress we are doing we're calculating a dot product between the two vectors. Can I do some more annotations? Maybe I can. So this bit here is essentially what we see here. Essentially. Now something is weird though. If we would use these weights in the weighted averaging, the values could go really wild. Because these weights, they result from a scalar product. It's not normalized in any way. They don't sum up to one. They can go completely riot. Let's try to avoid that. Let's say this is an intermediate result, W prime ij. And then let's say the real weights, Wij, we calculate these from softmax operation, which we use to normalize these weights and obtain a nice distribution where all the weights sum up to one. So we calculate essentially just softmax, right? W prime ij over the sum over j exponentiated w prime ij. That's just softmax. We normalize the weights through a softmax operation. And essentially, they are the dot product, which we normalize, and these weights we use to calculate the output. And we do that for each of the outputs individually, so that these attention weights, these Wij, will also change, or can change, from output to output. And this is exactly what attention is meant to achieve, that in order to produce a given output, different parts of the input might be more relevant or less relevant. And this more or less relevant, we are trying to capture using the dot product. That's not the only possibility. It's often used, but if you are interested, you can look at the attention mechanism in some more detail. You will see that different versions of attentions have been proposed. That's a very common one though, so it makes sense to focus on the dot product. Okay, now let's move on. We need a bit more than that. By now, every of our input vectors, every of the axes, appears in three different roles. And this is what you have seen here, how x2, the input vector corresponding to y2, which is the focus of our attention right now, it occurs multiple times. But also the other input vectors, they occur multiple times. And we can summarize in which roles these input vectors occur. So first of all, every input vector Xi is used in a way and compared to every other vector to establish the weights for its own output Yi. And this weight we could take as Wij. So we calculate the weight for the own output Yij. Let's go back trying to depict that. Each input vector is used and compared to all the other vectors in order to compute the weight for that output. That is something we see here. How x2 is used compared to calculate the weight for its own output to the others. But also we see the second role, or s second role of x2, I'm needing some color. On the one hand, x2 is used and compared to all the other vectors, that is this x2 here. And x2, new color, maybe blue. X2 is also used here in a different role. And when we calculate the weights for other outputs, then basically the vector that I just highlighted using purple color, that would change. That's always the input vector that corresponds to the current output. But the version of x2 that I highlighted in light blue, that would also be part of the calculations of the weights for other output vectors. That's yet another role. Calculate the weight of other outputs. And I have denoted them here by WZJ to stress that it's not output I, the own output of vector XI, but some other output and its weight. And overall, and other than that, that's not shown in the previous slide, or at least not highlighted, it's a bit of implicit, the input vector xi is also part of the weighted sum that we use to calculate the output yi. And not only yi, but every output. Maybe here we can see that when we look at the... Do I have one more color, maybe? Yellow, that's a bit hard to see. I mean, if we look at this calculation here, that is a weighted sum. For every output, we calculate a weighted sum. And in this weighted sums, every input vector will occur. That's yet the third role of the input vectors. And all these roles are not really distinguished by our current attention mechanism. It's everything is just added up. Everything is weighted and then added up together. But these different roles are not really taken account of. Should we, maybe? And you can guess the answer. I shouldn't do rhetorical questions. I don't like them myself. Let's call these three roles query role, key role, and value role. And let's also introduce some weight matrices that we apply in order to ensure that these weights, or that not these weights, that these vector products are not always the same, depending on the role that we currently focus on. Speaking about the weight matrices, how many parameters do we need to do self-attention? That feels so good. It feels very much as if standing in a lecture in front of a class, in front of a bunch of students asking questions, and silence is hitting you and consuming you and eating you. Anyways, maybe you have the answer, and maybe you are just shouting it out loud right now. I hope you do. That would be lovely. If you know the answer, just shout it to yourself, and then you will also feel as if in class and being able to show off a little bit with all your knowledge. We all should try to feel as if in class from every now and then. Considering the equations we have just written down, the number of weights in self-attention is zero. How is that possible? We have wij, w is a weight, how can the number be zero? By the way, we calculate wij just as a dot product between vectors that are given to us. Zero parameters so far. That's quite remarkable. That would suggest very fast training. It will not stay like that. No, right now we introduce weight matrices, a query matrix, a key matrix and a value matrix, and each of these matrices will be d by d, where d is our embedding dimension. And then we use these matrices to obtain a different representation of our input vector x. That's what the graph shown here is to resemble, but before making sense of the graph, let's add some equations. Let's do that in black color. So we introduce a new vector, which is qi, and we calculate qi by taking the weight matrix wq times xi. We are once more adopting the perspective that we have a given output yi and the corresponding input token xi. And everything changes for the next input or output token for I plus 1. But for our given token I, xi input token, we can calculate a new representation of that token, and we name that qi and call that the query representation. Likewise, we can calculate a representation ki, which we obtain in the same manner by multiplying xi with our weight matrix for the key role. And lastly, we can calculate vi by wv times xi to obtain a representation of the input when it occurs or is used in the value role. And you see these three representations highlighted in the picture using colors. Let's try to make some sense out of these pictures. First of all, where are my relevant tokens? This is token x2, and that is token x3. We won't need x1 and x4 in this example. Thanks to Peter Blohm for using nice colors to inform us which vector is what. Here we've got a vector that looks very much like x2. And we've got x3 over here. And we also got x3. That's a bit over here. But hold on, that can't be quite right, can it? I mean, the vectors look differently. Why does x3 look different in the blue example from its appearance in the green example? Well, the reason is that one time here we have the query matrix. The other time we have the key matrix. And lastly, we have the value matrix. And this is why also the vectors in the picture look a little bit different from the raw vectors x2 and x3. That's the idea, to highlight this. Let's maybe make one more step before trying to detail what's going on. It's not intuitively sensible, I believe. If you disagree, well done, but I believe that's not intuitively sensible what we are doing here. However, what should be clear is that, yeah, we can do that. Instead of using the input token xi, and when I say input token, of course, I always mean its embedding, we can split it up into three bits and introduce matrices in order to do the transformation. And then let's adjust our attention mechanism, where we need weights wij or w prime ij, and we can compute this by qi times kj, which is just the dot product. We had the dot product between two vectors before. We keep the same. We calculate the dot product between query and key. And then, how about my place? Well, wij as before. Wij will just be the softmax of w prime ij. That is just the normalization. That doesn't change. And lastly, we calculate the weighted sum. I will do that elsewhere. I will do that here. We calculate the weighted sum to obtain our output yi, which is a sum over j from 1 to t of wij, the computation of which we have just revised. And now we don't use xj as before, but rather use vj. Yeah. And now the representation of these vectors can adjust to different roles. That was the whole purpose. And these weight matrices, they are trained as part of training the network. A lot of free parameters that we introduce. Every matrix is D by D, which might be something like 100 times 100 or 300 times 300. So every of these matrices is big. They are, however, they don't change with the different input tokens. The values qi, ki, and vi, they change when xi changes. But these weight matrices, they remain fixed for all the inputs. We have one query matrix, one key matrix, and one value matrix. Each of these is D by D. And they are applied to every input token to obtain the query, key, and value representation of that token, which we need to calculate attention. And the attention scores, their calculation is as before, and the same logic that we had before applies. It's just that we have, hopefully, enriched the discriminatory power of the attention mechanism by taking into account that every input token shows up in these three different roles in the calculation of self-attention. And we allowed these roles to be, to just take account of the different role. We allowed the representation of the input token to change from one role to the next. The input token can have a different representation when we calculate the weights for that token's own output weight, wij. And the same token can have a different representation when we calculate the output weight of some other input token, WZJ. Now, these roles can have the same input in different representations. That is more flexibility at the cost of more parameters. And how these representations look, we don't know that. We just introduce these matrices, which initially are only D by D random numbers. And we count on the training algorithm on gradient descent and backpropagation to make sure that the weights in these matrices obtain suitable values in the end. That is the idea. And that is self-attention, or more specifically, that is single head self-attention. The output that we calculate in this way, sometimes that's called the output of one attention head. And maybe you remember that in the transformer we have multi-headed attention. So we do this multiple times. In a nutshell, we do this multiple times, and now I am using the equations that you might see when you look into other papers. I hope that with all the detour, you have experienced a gentle introduction. The idea of multi-head attention is again to make things more powerful, and one motivation could be that in a sentence a word has a different relationship with other parts of that sentence. The example could be the students liked the lecture, and then if we consider the word student, that word student expresses who liked something, and the word lecture on the other hand expresses what's the target of the emotion, or what was liked. And the word liked has therefore different relations to the word student than to the word lecture. And single-head attention could not really capture these different relations between words. It could have only one relation to all the other words in the sentence, and maybe that is not enough. So further enhance the attention mechanism to handle multiple different relations with different parts of the sentence by repeating the computations multiple times. And instead of the weight matrices W, Q, V, and K that we introduced before, we now add an additional index here, R, which runs over the multiple times we do that. That's called the multiple attention heads. That's a meta parameter of our network architecture. We can decide how many attention heads we want, and then every one of these attention heads is calculated as shown on the previous slide and has its own set of weight matrices for the key, the query, and the value representations of the input tokens. So if we have R attention heads, we have three matrices, each of which is D by D. So we have D by D times 3 times R as our number of parameter that we introduce. And I'm trying to summarize the equations, how multi-head attention is calculated. We start with the multi-head attention function, so the topmost element in the computations, which is based on three inputs, Q, K, and V, matrices. And then we essentially concatenate the outputs of the multiple attention heads, denoted by head 1, head 2, head 3, and all the way up to head R. We collect all these outputs, and then we apply that with yet another weight matrix, that is WO here, in order to project everything back to the dimension that we want to have in the end. And Jay Alamar did a nice job in trying to depict that. That's the graph from his blog that I'm using here, where he would say we start with input tokens X, and then we multiply these tokens with our weight matrices once for each attention head. So you see here all the weight matrices indexed with 0 because this is the first attention head. So for J, the first index in a sequence is 0. That's very computer science-y, as it should be, as in Python. And these calculations, they provide us with Q, K, and V, which are also indexed with 0. And when I now put... I admit that I'm not entirely happy with my notations. I'll tell you why in a minute, but I haven't found a better way right now. Here, I was using small letters, Q, K, qi, ki, and vi. And you know that I use small letters for vectors. These are vectors. Specifically, these are the vector representation of our input token xi across its different roles. So we have these ones per token, but in fact, if you implement that, you will not implement that by writing a for loop that runs over all the input tokens. You will vectorize your computations. You will collect all the input tokens in a matrix, and then multiply that matrix with your weight matrices, WQ, WK, WV. And this is why you see capital Q, K, and V here. It's the representation of all the inputs stacked together, all the inputs in the sequence. Also here, note the green representation of X. X is composed of X1 and X2. This is how to read that. We have two input tokens, X1, X2. Together, they make up X. And if we then take the matrix X and multiply that with our three weight matrices, WQ, WK, WV, we don't obtain output vectors as before, QI, VI, KI, but we obtain output matrices, capital Q, capital K, capital V. So the whole computation is done once for the sequence. And the output of an attention head, which is denoted as ZO here, ZO, Z1, Z, and so forth, once for every head, that in Alamoth block denotes the output of a single attention head. In the picture, this output just appears. That output is the result of the attention function, which does exactly what we have seen before. The attention function, you input three matrices, and then you calculate the scalar product of the matrices Q for query and K for key. You run that, you put that through a softmax, that gives you the weight. So, that part here is essentially what we had before, Wij. And then you multiply that with your matrix of the input tokens value representation denoted by V here. That is essentially Wij times Vi over J that we had before. That does not look like J at all. That looks a bit little bit like J. That is, oops, I'm sorry. Now I'm lost. It's getting worse. Here we are. This is where I want to go. Remember that bit. We calculate the output in the same way, but we do that once for all the input tokens and can do that conveniently by working with the matrices of all the inputs. One thing that is new here, it's a scaling parameter. We have the square root of d in the softmax. That's new. I didn't highlight it before. Could have done, but decided against. Ah, you know me, I just forgot about it. Here. That is a scaling parameter. And again, we could also have introduced it right here. The square root of, sorry, we use the square root of d, which is our embedding dimension, just to take account of the fact that the scalar product, its magnitude will typically grow the bigger is the embedding. And that's something we don't really want, so we scale it backwards. It's just a scaling parameter. It's nothing to worry about. It's also not a free parameter. It follows from the embedding dimension. And therefore, the attention mechanism doesn't really change tremendously. It's the same as before. On this slide, we emphasize that we can calculate that in one go for every input token. This is how we moved from vector representations, small q, k, and v, to matrix representations, capital Q, k, and v. The other calculations are as before, minus this scaling factor. Each head gives an attention output. In the picture, we have that 0, that 1, and so forth. And then we multiply, we concatenate all these vectors and multiply with the weight matrix, the new weight matrix WO, so that in the end, we have the output of our multiple attention heads in the same. Note how this is the same format as the input, and this is what we want. The values will differ, obviously, but we don't want the dimensions to change. Right. With this multi-head attention, one remark. There are two ways how you can implement that. There is the wide way and the narrow way. What I have explained so far is the wide way, where you would, for each attention head, have a specific and individual matrix WQ, WK, WV, which has D by D dimensions. Sometimes obviously this introduces a lot more parameters when using multi-head attention. Sometimes they do the calculations a little bit differently, and instead, if X has a certain input dimension, they split up X into pieces. Let's say you use 12 attention heads. They would split up X equally into 12 pieces. X is just a vector, it's just an embedding vector, right? If you have, let's say, as embedding dimensions, you have 120, the vectors of length 120, and you calculate multi-head attention with 12 heads, you would just take chunks of 10 elements of X, the first 10, the second 10, third 10, and the fourth, to calculate the multi-head attention. This is narrow multi-head attention, and the advantage is that your weight matrices are then smaller, and you don't increase the number of free parameters so much. That's multi-head attention. What else? That was the core, the heart of the transformer. One thing that's yet missing is the input. The transformer network has no sense of word order. All the words are compared to the other words to get these attention scores. Well, by doing so, comparing every word to all the other words, maybe this is the best way to depict that, it's automatically bidirectional, because you also look at the right context of a word when you calculate these attention scores. It's automatic, it's naturally bidirectional, but the order does not play a role. You could permute the order of the words in the input, and okay, the output would also be permuted. You would not have y1, y2, y3, y4 anymore. You would have maybe y4, 2, 3, and 1 if you permute the order, if you change the order of the tokens, but the values are exactly the same. So that's an example from a project with one of my PhD who does anti-social online behavior detection. In other words, classifies whether some post is offending or not. And there it is important to clearly distinguish between "you idiot" and "I was an idiot." So word order plays a role here. And so that's not taken account in self-attention, Word order does not play a role in self-attention. We could permute the word, would not change a thing. And of course, the creators of the attention of the Transformer Network were aware of that. And how they solved this, by adding positional embeddings to the network, input. You take the input words, you embed them, project them to vectors using Word2Vec, for example. But instead of then using these embeddings as input to the transformer, to the self-attention, they introduced another embedding, which is called a positional embedding. It's another vector that has the same dimension as the raw embedding or the token embedding, so that you can add these vectors up easily. And this positional embedding is to allow the network to learn, to tell the network something about the position at which a word occurred in the sentence, so that the network can learn the influence of the position. Okay, well, just that you know the details, essentially it's an embedding. If you have a word and embed that to a vector with dimension 300, you need a positional embedding, which is also a bunch of 300 numbers. And the way they calculate this, they used a sine and a cosine function of different frequencies depending on the position of a word in the input sequence and depending on the element in the positional embedding. You see the equations here. Here is a plot what you produce as values when running these equations. And this is basically how they produced a positional embedding that gives you a unique embedding vector for every position in the input sequence. So the word at the very beginning of your input sequence gets a different positional embedding, or the positional embedding of the first input differs from that of the second, that of the third, that of the fourth, that of the fifth, and so forth. It's a bit like you would add just the number of the word in the input sequence to the embedding. It's a bit like that. It's more clever, but that's sort of the idea. And this way you make the embedding of earlier words look different from that of later words, and you hope that your network can then pick up that frequential pattern in the input text. And then, well, that's basically the transformer, really. Let's check. We clearly talked about attention. So that's done, and well, let's not go into the minor details of what is masked multi-head attention. In the decoder, it's problematic if your attention mechanism would be bidirectional and if you would look ahead during the training. That's not possible. And if you do machine translation, you need to output the next word in the sequence, so you cannot look at that word. Otherwise, you have a circular relationship here. So you must make sure that you, when you calculate attention, only look at the left context. And therefore, you use mask to basically hide the right context at which you must not look. That was it. So attention we dealt with. Positional encoding, it was brief, but you have an idea. Feed-forward network, well, we didn't really detail that, but you know what that is. One last bit that I haven't really touched upon is this arrow here. We have it here, and we have it also here. The transformer also makes use of residual connections. They are like shortcuts. And drawing on J. Elmer's wonderful graphical notation, I created this graph actually myself just this morning. We have some words, the and students, we embed them, we add their positional embedding to obtain our input tokens, x1, x2. We feed these through our multi-head attention to obtain the attention outputs Z1 and Z2. And then in the transformer architecture, we see this green block, add and norm, that reoccurs. It's a normalization step where we sanitize, let's say, the input before we feed it to the next element in our architecture. Very much as in batch normalization. And why is it not called batch normalization but add and norm? The reason is that we have these residual connections where your input X, you put it through the attention mechanism to obtain that, but in addition, you allow the input X to bypass all the calculations in the multi-headed attention, take the raw X values, vectors, add them up with your attention outputs. If you add these values up, their range would normally also amplify. Because of that, you want to avoid that, you normalize once again. That's an intuition why you want to normalize, since you now add up these vectors. And then you go on with the next step, which is just a feed-forward neural network. The intuition of these residual connections is a thing invented in computer vision. It helps you to train deeper networks. The residual connections gradients can flow easily in the backward path along these connections to layers further down in the architecture. So it really helps with training these networks. That's the intuition. Not sure there is a theoretical result why it works. It's found effective, so it's used. Correct me and point me to theoretical results. Maybe there are. But the intuition is that we want to simplify the training by creating these shortcuts for the gradient to flow freely in the backward path. Freely means also that there are no, you know, activation functions that would somehow shrink gradient values, because the derivative of some activation lives only in a certain value range and thereby shrinks the numbers. All that is not going to happen on the when using these residual connections. Okay, but that really is the transformer and all the key elements in its architecture. Okay, noting that we have already spent a lot of time, let me quickly touch on GPT and a BERT, these two very famous deep NLP models. GPT came out first, then BERT, then GPT-2. GPT-2 makes a bunch of enhancements to GPT. Generative pre-training transformer, generative. Here we emphasize the task of generation. Certainly we use transformers. You see this architecture with multi-headed self-attention, the mechanisms we now know. And the input is an embedding matrix plus this WP here. Maybe you can guess what that is. Positional encoding. Remember, self-attention is agnostic of word order. So the approach to use positional embeddings, standard practice when working with transformers. We only use the right part of the transformer, only the decoder block. That is something that was new when GPT-2 came out, when GPT came out, discards the encoder part. They also use subword embedding of the input tokens using some byte pair encoding mechanisms. That's not to worry, but if you Google for byte pair encoding, you'll find your way. Multiple of these transformer blocks or stacked decoder blocks, not the full transformer, only stacked decoder blocks. And compared to, let's say, Elmo and Ulmfit, you really have this base model. Using GPT in downstream application, it was designed as a base model where you put something on top of it to approach your downstream task, like a linear layer and softmax for classification. But the whole deep GP2 model is the baseline model that you build on. That's clearly different from Elmo, where you still have a lot of pre-training. Another distinction clearly is that you use the transformer as opposed to LSTM or by LSTM layers. But this end-to-end training, as opposed to the how training is organized in ELMO and ULMFIT, that was a notable difference from previous models. And the authors put a lot of effort into elaborating and testing how their model would work for multiple NLP tasks. That's a similar objective that ELMO pursued. ULMFIT was geared toward text classification. GPT tries to be more general and support many NLP tasks. And then basically what this picture is to show that you have the core block, the deep GPT model, and that you can use that model together with some pre-processing of your input data to approach various NLP tasks like classification or entailment or similarity detection, answering multiple choice type of questions. The key take home here is you can augment the deep model minorly, tune some additional weights, and then use that in a variety of tasks. In ELMO, you have these contextualized vectors that you add to the input. Here you have the deep model that you reuse and then train in an end-to-end manner. That's the difference. And with regard to ULMFIT, ULMFIT allows you text classification, and I believe when you do text classification, conceptually GPT and ULMFIT are similar, in that in ULMFIT you also use the pre-trained language model and then you fine-tune that a little bit, but you couldn't do anything else but text classification. And one interesting thing, I believe, is that GPT also introduced that when you do the training on your target corpus, let's say you do text classification, when you train your model to do text classification on your target corpus, you not only minimize the classification loss, the cross entropy, but in addition, you minimize the language modeling loss. So here you have the cost function for GPT, which has two parts and a weighting parameter lambda to govern the importance of these two tasks. And the second task is language modeling loss. The first part is classification loss. That is for illustration. You could use GPT for other type of tasks and then replace this classification loss with a loss measure that is suitable for your downstream task. And yeah, if you think about it, it's a little different from ULMFIT, where you would do something similar. You would also tune, or you would also minimize language model loss in ULMFIT, but you do not do that in parallel, which GPT does, adopting this multitask perspective where the loss function has two parts or two components representing two different tasks. You do that in once, and in ULMFIT you have stage two where you do language model loss minimization on your target corpus, and then you have step three where you minimize classification loss on your target corpus. GPT says let's do that in one go. Some minor distinctions. Let's also have a look at BERT, which is maybe even more relevant to us, because with GPT-2 the focus was very much on text generation. That's the model that you want to start with, GPT-2, when you do language generation. This task is still a bit exotic for us as economists, I believe, or maybe I'm just biased and should say for people at in our group at the Chair of Information Systems. We are supporting some startups that go for language generation. If you are interested, then I could put you into context, but text classification is a more common task for us. So let's look at BERT, which is the go-to model for text classification, where GPT focused on the decoder part of the transformer, BERT is focusing on the encoder part and uses only that part, only the encoder. It's geared toward text classification, so on top of the transformer blocks, you always find a linear layer and subsequent softmax layer to predict probabilities. And with regard to the transformer blocks, you have two versions of BERT, a smaller one and a larger one, where the smaller one is not small, but it's smaller. And when you use BERT in downstream applications, the idea is that you can start from a pre-trained version, and then it is actually your decision. Using your target corpus, the minimum amount of tuning that you must do is to tune the weights in the last layer, in this linear layer where you take the outputs of the last transformer block and try to construct a probability distribution from that by applying a weight matrix, putting the raw scores through a softmax, and then getting your output probabilities. These dense layer weights you always have to tune. That's the minimal amount of tuning that you must be ready to undertake. Since the classification, we would usually use gross entropy loss. You could also tune further layers in the architecture. The other extreme to only tuning, opposite to only tuning the dense layer weights, would be to train all the layers, all the weights in all the layers in all these transformer blocks that you now know how they look like. That will take a lot of time, especially for a larger corpus. That will take a lot of time, I tell you. And yeah, you could also try to do a mix of these, training some of the inner BERT layers, some of these transformer layers, but not all of them. Depending on software and libraries, you might be able to do that to have a compromise between fine-tuning and adapting BERT a little bit to your target corpus, but still not, well, going through this massive amount of computation time and effort and cost. Now that we, I mean, you may have been put off by me spending so much time on the transformer, but now that we have talked so much about the transformer, we can really deal with BERT quickly. It's basically a transformer, just that we focus only on the encoder part. It uses transfer learning, of course. And what's maybe notable about the paper, they trained the model for two tasks, one being language modeling, and mask language modeling, to be precise. So they take an input text, mask certain words in that text, they basically hide that words and then make BERT predict the missing words. That's language modeling, but not in the classical sense that we always predict the word at the end of the sequence. Consecutively, mask language modeling means you just knock out some words, replace them with the token mask that you see here, and then try to predict the missing words. And the second task is next sentence predictions. They train BERT to detect when being fed with two sentences, classify whether these sentences are neighbors in the text, whether one follows the other, or whether there are not neighbors and occur at different positions in a document. And if you look at this picture, which once again comes from Jay's blog, you see some specialized tokens, CLS, mask, and SEP. Mask I already introduced. This token they use for mask language modeling. The CLS token is basically what they put into BERT to tell the model, give me a classification. And the SEP token is to have a delimiter between two sentences. So the lower picture says, give me a classification. The man, and then the sentence goes on, but some word is missing. Maybe the missing word here, it could be, we don't know, but I think it is. Knowing the block, I think that is entered. That would fit into that sentence, right? So just that you don't get confused about this math, the man entered the store, sap. So that's the end of the sentence, the man entered the store, how exciting. And then it goes on with pension and some other words. Obviously, or likely, let's say, in this example, this sentence starting with the word pension is not the next sentence in the original document. It appears to be a weird context. The man entered the stores and then pensioned it something, referring to the cute little bird. So the separation token is important to tell the model of sentence one, sentence two, and then the class token indicates that we seek a classification, and if we feed the model with this type of input, token, separator, token, and class at the beginning, we get a classification whether the first input sequence is directly followed in the document by the second input sequence. And apparently training a model to perform that task, if you say, is that task useful for anything? No, not by itself, but apparently it helps the model to make sense out of language. It teaches the model to understand language and then detect that if a man enters the store, that has little to do with whatever some pension is doing. In terms of dataset, they had two corpus, English Wikipedia and a books corpus, both of which, of course, were big, unsurprisingly. And the input structure was also somewhat interesting, where they had, as usual, token embeddings. And as usual with transformer models, Devlin et al. Also used position embeddings. And of course, these specific tokens, class and separation. And they had also segment embeddings, which was needed because they, as part of the pre-training, fed their model with tokens from two different sentences. And they're needed, or they introduced an embedding, which was all the same for the tokens of the first sentence, and then different from the tokens in the second sentence. You see this EA and EB here, right? That basically, that's what I'm talking about. That's the segment embedding. All this is added up to give the final embedding that is fed into the transformer encoder block. Last remark, BERT would also support the extraction of contextualized embeddings, a bit like ELMO. Or you could get that. Not sure whether, probably, definitely not every library that you might use would allow you to do that. Maybe some might, others, you might also have to do a bit of coding yourself. But conceptually, since you stack multiple encoder blocks, every token gets multiple embeddings. The output of each encoder layer along the token path, you could follow that and collect all these different representations of the input token and then construct a weighted average of these representations in order to contextualize the embedding of the word in an ELMO-like manner. But you know that when you use ELMO, this contextualization has some additional weights that you need to train alongside the standard training of your task model. You would do the same. You would have to do the same here if you want to use BERT to extract contextualized embeddings. Okay, so NLP deep learning, quo vadis. Enormous progress over the last years. And you have seen the cutting edge approaches, ELMO, Olmfert, then the GPT, transformers. I was brief on that for the reasons explained. And BERT. Since you know the transformer, you can then read these papers now quite easily, I believe. And these models are powerful. There is a nice anecdote accompanying the GPT-2 model. When it first came out, it was so powerful in generating language that the authors did not make the model available to the public, which was unusual. Most NLP models like BERT and Olmfert and the others, embeddings were made publicly available so that others could use these models in downstream applications. And with GPT-2, the creators felt that is too dangerous. The potential for misuse is just too high. Misuse as in creating, you know, fake news or fake posts. It's a language generation model. And the language it generates that was so close to human language and almost indistinguishable from human author that the authors or the creators of GPT-2 were hesitant to make the full version, the most powerful version with the largest number of parameters and train on the biggest corpus, publicly available. By now it has become publicly available. A year later after it originally came out. So meanwhile, the perspective has changed. Not the perspective has changed, but the increase in technology and computational power nowadays does not really necessitate to hold back that model. For instance, you have Megatron, which is yet a bigger model. So, yeah. But it's a nice anecdote that these models are so powerful that they are also dangerous. And the whole field of deep fakes, which is most prevalent in the scope of computer vision and faked videos, but deep fake also encompasses textual data, and there clearly is risk that we need to be aware of and that we as a community need to manage somehow. Other criticism, albeit the possible misuse of these models, comes from the fact that their training is so costly, uses enormous amounts of computer power and energy. Many mention that it's non-trivial to estimate that reliably and rigorously how much energy is needed for these models to train, but there is one nice paper that you could have a look at if you are interested, Energy and Policy Considerations of Deep Learning in NLP. Very, very recent paper, still on archive, right? And that's a valid point. Do we need the extra amount of accuracy that a bigger model would give us, given that training this bigger model uses so much energy? Is that really legitimate to do that? Question mark. I don't know. It's important to also see that perspective of these models. Another criticism, and here I come back to the paper of Merity, which I like a lot, is that, albeit all the energy bit, the additional accuracy that you get using BERT, let's say, of using BERT large compared to some vanilla RNN type of language model, maybe with attention, you just don't need it. And in that paper, Merity reports some results where he came close to bird-like performance with a much simpler model that requires a lot less training, just an RNN-based model, very much as the ones we have seen earlier on. Which is good, because that paper really reminds us that if you felt we spent too much time on RNNs, read that paper and you will see, maybe we didn't spend too much time on RNNs. Speaking about spend too much time, I wanted to familiarize you with the state of the art in NLP and understand how the word embeddings, the shallow word embeddings, have issues that triggered these developments that we have been discussing in our lecture. You have seen a lot of NLP transfer learning in different flavors for many well-known and important type of models. Apologies for the long time that I spent on this single third lecture. But if you really go through all the stuff, if you make it through all that stuff, you have a so rock-solid understanding of what's going on in the field of deep learning-based NLP, you can really give yourself a pat on the shoulder. If you like that stuff and seek some more, I would recommend you to read the attention paper. Attention is all you need. maybe starting with the annotated transformer from Harvard NLP group, or Jay Allemer's wonderful blog to put my slides in more context. And that was really it. We have one more session, which will be on convolutional neural networks, and I promise you that this last lecture will not be as long as this one. As always, at this point, thank you so much to all the great resources that helped me creating this lecture and explaining concepts without having to draw every picture myself, Jay Allemer's blog, the blog of Peter Bloom, very notable here. Lillian Wang also has a beautiful blog on language models in general, and she goes through numerous important concepts. And of course, the standard textbooks Dive into Deep Learning and Stanford Course of Natural Language Processing. The moment Transformers came out and became so popular, they revised their materials and now cover these models as well. Here are all the papers I was citing along the way. And that really is it. I thank you very much for being so patient, and I wish you a good morning, evening, day, whenever you watch this ahead. Thank you so much, and see you next time for the convolutional neural networks lecture.